Batman 89, issue 2, and Superman 78, issue 2, published by DC Comics. Batman 89 is the sequel to Tim Burton's Batman Returns, ignoring the awful Joe Schumacher movies. Likewise, Superman 78 is the sequel to Richard Donner's Superman 2, ignoring the three bad sequels that follow. Now, do these nostalgia baits live up to the cinematic classics from 30 and 40 years ago? Let's find out. Sadly, as you can already tell, Batman 89 is... Batman 89 is a disappointment. Issue 1 really disappointed me, and issue 2 is much worse. Issue 2 focuses more on injecting Black Lives Matter and other contemporary political crap, rather than bothering to tell a proper story with resemblance to the films that it should be trying to be a sequel to. Oh yes, for the second month in a row, Batman 89 has failed. Issue 2 had a few okay moments. My favorite being the long-awaited return of Catwoman, or rather, Michelle Pfeiffer's Catwoman. She's the main reason I'm still reading this trash. Sadly, she was not sufficient to curb the flaws of this pretentious piece of propaganda book that is devoid of the fun, neo-noir, timeless appeal that made the Tim Burton movies so great. Oh, and I called it last issue. As expected, Black Robin ended up calling out Bruce on his white privilege, and other people as well. And Bruce Wayne spent most of the issue struggling with his white guilt. Ugh, bum-atrocious. Two-Face was also very racist towards his fiancée Barbara, refusing to let her come to Burnside, which is the black community of Gotham. Seriously? Barbara, if I were you, I would have dumped that a-hole a long time ago. You deserve better. Well, no, not really. You're a real B-word as well. Barbara is awful in this book. This is easily the worst version of Barbara Gordon. Ironically, the Joe Schumacher version of Barbara, named Barbara Wilson, was way better than this Barbara from this horrible book. If you want to tackle contemporary social issues, do it elsewhere. This is entertainment, dammit. And escapism. The Tim Burton films were true escapism. This book is not. So shame on you, Sandham. You helped write the Tim Burton movies and now you're ruining this universe. You had one job, to write a period piece set in the freaking 1990s. Not push Antifa 2020 propaganda garbage like every other liberal scumbag medium these days. Oh yes, they even made a group of white men dressed as Batman who are based on Frank Miller's Dark Knight Returns act like the lunatics that attacked the Capitol building during the insurrection of January 6, 2021. I'm fuming. This stupid book had no ounce of subtlety. And of course, there's even a George Floyd moment where the Gotham police and the National Guard end up escalating a conflict in Burnside, and that ends up leading to some protests. Very much like what happened last year in 2020, Oh goodness, talk about subtlety, which this book has none. And don't get me started on Robin. Marlon Wayans' Robin is awful. The dumbest moment of the book goes to Robin and how he gets his name. Talk about cringeworthy. Let me show you the pages. It's a really stupid pun. Ugh. This book does not feel like the world of the Tim Burton films in the slightest. It is clear this was Batman 89 in name only. How disappointing. I was excited and on board, but also wary from the moment they race-swap Harvey Dent and Robin. Why, you ask? No, I'm not racist. The problem is, I take issue with all of this political garbage. Because for some stupid reason, whenever you have black superheroes, unimaginative idiots always make them political mouthpieces, victims of hate crime, instead of moving past that tired trope of fake activism and treating them as true equals whose skin color is irrelevant to a fun superhero story. I don't feel like reviewing Batman 89 anymore. Screw this book. Superman 78, on the other hand, I love it. It's a fun story that knows what it is and doesn't preach some contemporary political agenda. It feels like something from 1978, and it isn't pretentious. That's solid proof that Robert Venditti is a much better writer than Sam Hamm. We begin with Gene Hackman's Lex Luthor, who is out of prison on parole and has just been asked by Superman to help him figure out what the flock and slime Brainiac is. Because, as we saw last issue, Brainiac sent a drone to attack Earth, and Superman was really caught off guard. Meanwhile, Margot Kidder's Lois Lane and her contact from the SETI organization, which is an organization in real life that focuses on tracking potential communication with alien life forms in the universe, they also are investigating Brainiac. But alas, this is all too late because the big bad Brainiac has arrived and he is trying to convince the world that he's doing them a favor by attacking Superman and trying to collect him, because according to Brainiac, Superman and all Kryptonians are an invasive species. And I mean, Brainiac is not wrong. I'm sorry, Superman, but Kryptonians are an invasive species on Earth. Just ask General Zod. Although, this is more of an exercise in the whole nurture versus nature debate. Superman was nurture, and therefore, he's a good Kryptonian. And that is proven by how much the people of Earth love Superman. Yes, in a very surprising and refreshing wholesome twist, the people of Earth aren't convinced by Brainiac's rhetoric, and they actually want Superman to remain on Earth, despite the danger that he poses to them. It's very sweet, and it shows how beloved Superman is. It also reminded me of that scene from 2002's Spider-Man, when the New Yorkers threw stuff at Green Goblin in order to help Spidey, and they were very vocal of their support for their city's hero. And speaking of Spidey, it also reminded me of the scene from 2004 Spider-Man 2. You know, that one scene that everybody talks about. The train battle scene. In the aftermath, when Spidey passes out and the people inside the train end up saving him from falling. It's very sweet. I love that scene. What follows is also another beautiful moment of self-sacrifice from Superman. In that moment, and the whole dialogue, I kept being reminded of Christopher Reeve, and I kept reading Superman's dialogue in Christopher Reeve's distinctive voice. I miss Christopher Reeve. Rest in peace. Also, rest in peace, Margot Kidder. You were awesome. I love you in Black Christmas and in Superman. In Superman 2. Gene Hackman's Lex Luthor was also hilarious. I laugh at Lex Luthor's antics, especially one scene that takes place in a taxi cab. Margot Kidder's Lois Lane wasn't bad either. In recent years, I have hated Lois Lane, because she always comes off as such a B-word. But here, Robert Venditti's characterization captures Margot Kidder's charisma beautifully. Wonderful issue all around with great moments. My second favorite moment after Superman's surrender was when Superman reached for his chest emblem and he pulled out another cellophane shield like he did in Superman 2 when he used it against General Zod and his minions. In this case, Superman reached for his chest and pulled out another shield and used it to envelop Brainiac's android sentries. I also love the artwork of Wilfredo Torres. I never get tired of looking at it. It's simple. It has an elegance that is very... He manages to capture perfectly the likeness of the actors. And it really feels like you're watching... And it really feels cinematic. And it really feels cinematic while not being too overly detailed. Sam, final verdict. Munch It for Superman 78 issue 2, and Slime It for Batman 89 issue 2. Thank you for watching. Sorry if I lost my cool. It's just Batman 84. Sorry if I lost my cool. It's just that Batman 89 really pissed me off this month. Thankfully, we had Superman 78 issue 2 to cushion the blows and make things better. Sam, see you next time. Au revoir. Night-night.